Well, guys, we're back in the man cave. Last week we took a little tour, pretty much this half of the man cave. It's not really a trophy room, it's just a man cave. And this is where I hang out with my family when we're bored and want to goof around a little bit. Sometimes my friends, when they're coming to hunt with me, they'll stay here. And everybody likes to ask me if I'd show them my mounts. They're not all here, but I have a lot of them here, and these are some of my favorite ones. So we showed you half of them last week. And let's get started. We'll look at some more now. This guy here, I might get choked up talking about hunting him, but this big old wolf, I was up Ontario, and it took me years to kill a wolf. And I always felt like the wolf, if you can kill a wolf with your bow and arrow, that the wolf is probably the greatest challenge for a bow hunter. Unless you're shooting him over bait, because the wolf is cunning and he's very skillful at hunting and he's very wary of his surroundings, and he has lived through the hardest persecution for man than any animal on the planet and has come out on top. So to kill one with a bow and arrow one-on-one is pretty magnificent feat, and I've got a few friends that have done it, but there's not too many folks that have killed one intentionally. Usually they're moose hunting or doing something else where they actually killed a wolf. And this particular wolf, which is the big alpha male, I had been hunting wolves for several years, and this winter I had set my sights on it's a wolf or nothing. And to make a long story short, days passed and I got out of the blind one evening when I heard him howling several miles in the distance, and I just grabbed my camera, my tripod, and my bow, and I took off through the forest directly at him. And I came upon a big lake that I didn't even realize was there. This was before you have Onyx maps and all that good stuff. I came through the forest onto this frozen lake, and I knew I was in their whereabouts, and I howled. And sure enough, they answered. And I got on the edge of the lake, and him and
howl again.
Him and three others came looking for me, and they were up on a ridge above the lake looking and staring and trying to find me. And eventually he came down on the lake, but he never came right at me. He started to swing. I could tell he was using the wind to his favor. He was well within rifle range the whole time that he stepped on the water on the lake, but as he swung, I could tell he was not going to get much closer. So I shot him at about 85 yards.
Close enough. I hit him. I hit him good.
Shot him through the heart. It was a pretty amazing moment for me, even though the video is kind of weak because I was self-filming, but I did capture the hit, and he ran out of the screen. I wasn't even sure I hit him good. I thought I kind of hit him in the leg, but I let him go. And that night it snowed a little bit, and I about froze to death out there because I was so far from my truck, but I got through it and went looking for him, and I could follow his tracks through the snow. You could see his prints, but it had snowed the night before, and there was a blanket of snow in the forest over the fresh tracks. But you could see his little imprints, and if I would scuff the snow, you could see the blood underneath it. And as I followed it, he walked like a wolf normally won't walk. He was going under things and under big trees and bushes. He was almost like he knew I was behind him. And he was trying to lose me, but I found him in a blanket of snow, dead.
He's got a big old blocky head on him. Look at those fangs. Look at that.
So this is the tar that I shot running at 140 yards.
You can watch that on my YouTube channel, which you're watching now probably. But I shot him first at 35, 40 yards running over a cliff. Got that video, pretty cool. Here's some of my spears. I threw the spear in college, basically, the javelin. Paid my way through college with a dang spear. But I told my coach, and Roger Haynes, he's a good guy, man. He's still working at the college. He's gone all the way to the top now. He's the athletic director. Pretty proud of Roger. But he gave me my javelin, which got me through college. And I told him, I said, Roger, when I kill my first pig with that spear, I'm gonna name it after you, buddy. And sure enough, I took that spear home and I had my dad put he welded a point on the front of it. And that summer I went down to South Texas and walked a creek bank and found a big boar that was getting a drink. And I slocked him in the river.
While the big boar's vision was blocked, I slid in above him, hoping to catch sight of him where I could get a good throw. As I moved in, I finally saw the top edge of his back. The boar threw his head up, and I knew it was time to make my throw.
Part of his liver fell out when he ran out of the water up on the hill. This is a Neil guy, another really cool animal that I'm proud of, because the Neil guy are extremely intelligent animals, and they have eyes unlike anything else, exceptional at hearing. They don't come to bait, so you got to try to spot and stalk them. You could kill them off water, I suppose, if you found a dry enough season in South Texas near the King Ranch. But I snuck up on this guy with my brother Buck. Buck filmed it and I slocked him.
Still aren't able to kill one, but finally we got it done. What a beautiful animal. Look how fat and healthy he is.
This here is a pretty awesome trophy. I mean, at the time, we didn't know anything about it. My son was only, I think he was about 8 years old. And he shot this big gar. You can watch it on YouTube. Shot it with his bow. And would have been the world record at the time. It's 8'7" long, but we didn't even turn it in or nothing. We just, we actually skinned it and then ate it. So anyway, that was a monumental day. Here's the last legal raven that came out of Alberta. I shot that years ago. I guess you can shoot them up there now on private property, but at the time they tried to outlaw killing the dang raven of all things. But I was on a wolf hunt and I was walking out of the woods that day, and if you know anything about me, you know I like to shoot at birds, and I heard a raven call in the distance, so I answered him. They have a distinct sound. It's not like a crow. It's a wah, 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 wah. It's more of a echoey sound.
Wah, wah.
A crow, he's
ah, ah, ah.
But a raven's a
wah, wah.
And I gave him a couple of those, and by golly, he answered me once, and I knew he was coming. There was a wall of trees right in front of me, so I drew my bow. When he was coming, I just got a glimpse of him because their eyes are amazing. And when he came over the top of that spruce right in front of me, instantly he saw me at the same moment. Well, the wind was in his back, so he had trouble flaring and getting away. So when he went to flare, he kind of went straight up and I smoked him, broke his neck. One blade from that Grim Reaper trimmed his neck, cut some of the feathers off, but cut his jugular and snapped his neck, and he flopped dead right in front of me. So that's why I mounted him. It's another moment in my life I'll never forget. Here's a big old rattlesnake. This is a huge rattlesnake that Buck caught. Buck likes snakes. I think they're gonna bite him one day, but he's old now, so if he gets bit, it's okay. But back in the day when we were younger chasing snakes in South Texas, I've seen him get bit on the boots many times, and they strike at him all the time. He's just never got. It's not his turn, but it's coming.
All right, the
tricky thing about a snake like this is you want to pin his, you want to pin, get him perfect behind the head. That way he can't twist on you. All right, God, look at the size of that thing. That is a freaking monster rattler. Holy crap. Ooh, this makes me a little bit nervous. You know, we hunt down here in South Texas, and we track stuff in the, you know, we track wounded animals all through the South Texas brush country, and these are the, oh!
Here's another beautiful African animal. I love hunting Africa.
And it's always a plus when your guide wakes you up whispering big kudu right below the blind. The mortally hit kudu obviously has no idea he's about to die. He's startled, but still runs as though he's just worried about what's behind him, not what's in him. But the end is near, and the Grim Reaper claims its victim in short time.
Some of my animals there. I always kept my skulls. This is the one that, of all the animals I've shot in all my life, this is the one animal that more people ask me questions about. That's him there. That's actually, most people think that's a brown bear, but the truth is it's a giant grizzly bear. And I shot that bear. That was one of the first animals that we ever videoed getting killed. It was the first season of Relentless Pursuit.
My grandpa always said, life comes down to a few short moments. I was about to experience one of mine.
Back a little.
He's dead.
Stay back. Yeah.
I knew it was a big bear, but I never realized how huge it really was until I saw Hodge's first reaction when he seen the dead grizzly. It was over. My lifelong dream had just come true.
That's gotta be Safari Club Head Easy. I would bet that's Pope and Young Easy. Safari Club with boas.
This thing's bigger than an elk.
I don't think I can even pull this one over. He just laid right back. Laid right back out.
Look at the head on this thing compared to my head.
Size 10 boots don't even go across.
Seen an animal like this before. He's been eating some blueberries.
He
We've been
deep.
Who's that in for a
snuck up on him, took a shot, hit him right square between the eyes, killed the bear instantly. I couldn't believe it. I was backing Tim up with a rifle, and if the bear was going to attack him or anything, I was to stop the bear, and there was no need for me to have to do anything. And I'm glad it was, because Tim got right in line with me and the bear, and I couldn't have shot until the bear ate him anyway, so I'm glad he killed him instantly. But it's a fantastic bear. And
to my surprise, we later found out that the gun was jammed. There would not have been a backup shot.
Looked to me like he needed a pedicure. I don't know. Boy, it's fantastic. He could rip a guy to pieces with those.
When it was all said and done, the huge bear measured out nearly 9 feet square. Biologists later aged the bear. It was 26 years old. Its teeth were nearly all rotted. This bear was probably entering its last winter. The arrow took the bear instantly. Starvation or sickness often takes months to claim its victims. So it was a perfect ending for a beautiful animal.
And I shot that bear right between the eyes. It dropped him stone dead right in his tracks. And after I shot that bear, they didn't keep videoing because we were amateurs, didn't know what we were doing, but that bear never even wiggled. I mean, I've shot 1,000 animals, big animals that dropped in their tracks, and usually they kick a little bit or whatever, but that bear, that arrow went right through his skull and went through the brain, and you can see the tip. It's still sticking out the center of the spinal cord. Get a good focus on that, Steve. It's just an amazing moment in my life. And when I brought the video back to camp, my dad was in camp. He had been black bear hunting. He had went a different way with a different guide. He looked in the video camera and we replayed it. And he said, Tim, that shot will be heard from around the world. And at the time, I never realized it, but he was right. It was an old, old bear. Look at his teeth. They were nearly all rotted. They later aged that bear, and it was 26 years old. It's pretty amazing. And the biggest question everyone always asks me is, that where you were aiming? A lot of times I'd say that's between me and the bear, but I don't have anything to hide. I'll tell you the truth. You know, I don't aim at nothing. I'm instinctive. I just shoot my bow and that arrow goes where God wants that arrow to go. And at that moment, I was deadly back in those days. I'm not nearly as good with my bow as I once was, but back then I could actually shoot a bumblebee out of the air.
Bumbles!
Woo! Out of the air. Back then the arrows traveled a lot slower, they were a lot heavier, but they were just as deadly if you could hit the mark. But I was pretty good with my bow back then. I wish I was still that good. You know, these guys here, they're pretty cool animals. But one of the most famous animals that I've ever shot, also, the animal was amazing that I killed him that way, but I hunted these stinking goats. Goats aren't hard to kill, but for some reason, these goats at this place in South Texas that I was hunting are really hard to kill because they were hunted heavy by bow hunters, and a lot of rifle hunters hunt them there too. One of the few places you can find wild goats. And I tried for a week to kill one with my blowgun, but I noticed they always go to this horse tank out in this pasture, and there was nowhere to hide around it, and I put up a double bull blind and they wouldn't get near it, so they knew what was going on. Well, I thought, you know, it's going to be hot tomorrow. It was like 80 degrees, so I got in the tank. And sure enough, these goats, about 3 hours later, I was all shriveled up from head to toe, but by the time I was about had it with the tank, here they came.